Ladies and gentlemen, if you need to ask questions, you can go to question and answer here. Minimize the chat as much as you can, and I will leave the floor to our exceptional moderator tonight, Professor Samir Elansary and Professor Khaldar Ridwan, to introduce two distinguished speakers tonight. And I will leave the floor now to Prof. Samir Elansary. He's very welcome. I am so honored to be here tonight in the presence of His Excellency. Thank you very much.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Good evening, my dear colleague. Good evening, our attendees. Really, today, it's my great pleasure for me today to introduce two famous and two professional guest speakers, really, who are possessing proficiency in both academic and clinical skills. Their academic knowledge and activities are highly attractive and actively participating in different scientific meetings. And I want to thank Professor Dr. Engi and Professor Dr. Hesham Elazzazi for giving us today or this night a chance or opportunity to sharing them their highly experienced in two important topics today. The first topic, one lung ventilation, which is very important as you know, will be presented by my dear, really my dear colleague, Professor Dr. Hesham Elazzazi, Professor of Anesthesia, Intensive Care and Pain Management in Shams University. Welcome, Dr. Hesham and Mike, for you now.
Thank you, sir, for this valuable introduction. So I will start share screen now. My name is Hesham Elazzazi, as a professor for anesthesia and intensive care and interventional pain management. My topic is one lung ventilation. I am from Ain Shams University, Cairo, Egypt. I always wonder who was the first one to give anesthesia. This question I always ask, what the exact time the anesthesia started. But actually, when you search for in history, you find many clues and many hints about old civilizations which gave already anesthesia. In Egypt, there is a famous temple called Temple of Komombo. It is built in Egypt. It is from Ptolemaic dynasty, 180 before calendar, BC. This mountain, this wall, it shows a very interesting subjects. You can see here a basin or a sink to wash the hand, and it contains all the surgical instruments. As you see, balance, bowel knife, male catheters, probes, scalpels, flasks, sponge. You can imagine, of course, if you wanted to do surgery and you have a bassin to wash your hand, a scalpel, they are very advanced. And if you will do anesthesia, you will do surgery, so you must have anesthesia. So you can imagine from more than 2,000 years old, some civilizations started to give the anesthesia to their people. This is Ain Shams University Medical School. We have around 18 hospitals belong to the Ain Shams, in different from surgery to cardiothoracic to general hospitals. We are a very big and very old university in Cairo. This is the main building of administration. My topic is one lung ventilation. I will go through the physiological aspects during the thoracic anesthesia, lateral decubital position, open pneumothorax, and one lung ventilation. What the meaning of one lung indication, physiological effects, and techniques of one lung ventilation. And one lung ventilation in special conditions, like patient with tracheostomy, pediatric patients, and how to do one lung ventilation in a patient with difficult intubation. At first, the physiological aspects, there are a unique three difference from the ordinary anesthesia and this type of thoracic anesthesia. This is the curve for the volume pressure curve, which is known by compliance curve. And you can see here the, 1 minute, I will do something here. Sorry for this interruption. Yes. You can see the comparison between the compliance of the both lungs, dependent and non-dependent lung during awake and during anesthesia. In the awake state with the spontaneous breathing, there is ventilation perfusion matching because the dependent lung receives more air and more ventilation, and in the same time it receives more blood. So more perfusion and more ventilation, and this help the matching. Blood will go to the dependent parts due to the gravity, and the ventilation go to the lower lung due to the powerful contraction of the dependent hemidiaphragm, which is more efficient in the dependent part than the independent part. Again, during general anesthesia, this matching will change to mismatching. So perfusion is still present by the gravity to the lower lung, but the ventilation will be decreased, and it will go, again, I will show you the, this curve, the lower lung will receive the poorer ventilation, but still it receives more perfusion. So you will get ventilation, perfusion, mismatching. The cause for the decrease in the ventilation is due to decrease in the functional residual capacity, which caused by the anesthesia itself, and the dependent chest wall is constricted by the operation table itself and by the support and the beam bags which we put to hold the patient in position. Also, the intra-abdominal pressure, it increased with general anesthesia, and this decreased the diaphragmatic movement, opening the dependent, the non-dependent side of the chest, further increased the difference in the compliance between the two sides. All these factors will make the ventilation in the lower lung becomes less. On positive pressure ventilation, there is further mismatching. So here you can observe that mechanical ventilation, it will produce worsening of the condition, will not improve the condition. So mechanical ventilation will push more ventilation to the upper lung because it is in the more compliant part of the curve, and muscle paralysis, which will do during anesthesia, allow the abdominal content to rise up further against the dependent hemidiaphragm. Actually, there is another physiological effects that happen during the thoracic anesthesia is the opening of the chest itself. You know that the lung is kept distended by the negative glomerular pressure around it. So if you open the chest, we will lose this negative glomerular pressure, and the upper non-dependent lung will collapse. So during open pneumothorax, when we take a breath, we will get two effects, the mediastinal shift and the paradoxical respiration. You can see the image here during inspiration, when this person in the upper image, he will take breath, the air will go from his nose through the trachea and go to the lower lung, because the lower lung is still distended, but the upper lung is now is collapsed due to opening of the chest. In the same time, the air from the upper lung will go to the upper lung. So we will get collapse of the chest. At the same time, the lower lung will become distended and the upper lung will become obstructed. So this leading to mediastinal shift. The mediastinum will go to the up. During expiration, the reverse occur. The air will go from the lower lung. Some air go to the upper lung and some air go to the nose, through the trachea. So the chest becomes distended. These physiological changes makes the chest unstable for the surgeon. It will reduce paradoxical respiration and we call it pendulum breathing. It is like pendulum of the clock. The mediastinum go up and down, go up and down. These physiological effects which occur due to opening of the chest, it will completely disappear if we will use mechanical ventilation. So mechanical ventilation here will correct this pendulum breathing and will correct the paradoxical respiration because mechanical ventilation will produce inflation of both lungs, the dependent and the non-dependent in the same time, and decreasing the pneumothorax and increase chest inflation during the inspiration. The third physiological aspect during one lung ventilation is how to produce this one lung separation. Sometimes we call one lung separation, one lung ventilation. Of course, we collapse the upper lung because usually the patient take the lateral decubitus position and we will do collapse to the upper lung. The upper lung, sometimes it is the diseased lung, but sometimes we collapse a normal lung to facilitate surgery. So the thoracotomy here is not for the diseased lung to do pneumonectomy or something like that. No, you can collapse the lung to do surgery in esophagus, in mediastinum. So sometimes we work on the diseased lung and other times we work on normal lung. The indications, we classify them to patient related and they are usually absolute indications to isolate the lung, protect the other lung from infection. If there is one lung infected, so we can protect the other lung from the infection or from bleeding, to do separation of ventilation of each lung separately. Bronchoalveolar fistula, we sometimes use on the trachea bronchial disruption, large lung cyst or poly, surgical procedures on major conducting airway, unilateral bronchopulmonary lavage, severe hypoxemia due to unilateral lung disease. There is also procedures related to facilitate the surgical exposure, and they are mostly relative indications. The difference between relative and absolute means that you should do, you must do. But relative, we can do with special precautions. Sometimes we not need to do. This is the difference between relative and absolute. Repair of thoracic aortic aneurysm, lung resection, esophageal surgery, mediastinal exposure, single lung transplantation, anterior approach to the thoracic spine, and thoracoscopy video robotic assisted. This is maybe absolute indication. One lung ventilation will produce hypoxia. And I write here hypercarbia. But actually, we always confronted with hypoxia. The collapsed lung is no longer ventilated, but still perfused. So there is a right to left intrapulmonary shunt. It usually from 20 to 40%, but you can imagine half of the cardiac output from the right heart go to the upper lung and the other half go to the lower lung. If you collapse the upper lung, so you can expect that the chance is 50%, not 20 to 40. I always think why the chance is only 20 to 40%, not as I was expecting, it is 50%. If you collapse one lung and you will do no ventilation in the upper lung, you can expect that the hypoxia will be severe and the shunt will be severe. But the blood flow to the upper lung, which is not ventilated lung, is decreased. Actually, it's decreased due to three main factors. Hypoxic pulmonary vasoconstrictive reflex. The blood vessels of the pulmonary circulation has a unique characters from other blood vessels all over the body. Hypoxia all over the body will be reduced vasodilatation, except in the pulmonary. We get with hypoxia vasoconstriction. In the coronary, in the GIT, in the skin, when you get hypoxic, you will be vasodilated. But here, the reverse. This is the main cause will shift the blood from the upper non-dependent lung to the lower lung. And this decreases the effect of collapsing lung and will decrease the effect of hypoxia. Also, the pathological conditions in the upper non-dependent lung, it has effect and will produce more hypoxic pulmonary vasoconstrictive reflex. So this reflex allow us to produce collapse of the upper lung without expecting much hypoxia. Also, the surgeon will do surgical compression to the upper lung by retractors, and this will produce more shift of the blood to the dependent lung away from the non-ventilated upper lung. About hypercardia, the main problem during one lung ventilation is the hypoxia. But hypercardia, we are usually not see the hypercardia because there is two effect occurs to reverse to each others. A decrease in the dead space tidal volume ratio and this increase CO2 excretion, but in the same time an increase in the pulmonary shunt which decrease CO2 excretion. So you will get CO2 is the same, will not change usually in most cases. It is unchanged CO2 elimination, provided that the minute ventilation and the tidal volume are unchanged and there is no pre-existing hypercardia. Of course, when we find hypoxia, we try to do measures to prevent or treat this hypoxia. There is many trials. I search in all over the references. I found about 10 or 11 something we can do during one lung ventilation to decrease this hypoxia. Because also 20 to 30% which occur during one lung ventilation in the shunt and hypoxia, it is much and we want to prevent it completely. So all cases of thoracic anesthesia with one lung ventilation, we should use 100% oxygen. And we start to do some ventilatory setting to adjust the parameters of ventilator to help us to prevent this hypoxia. Tidal volume, we should always keep it from 8 to 12 milliliter per kg, the same as the two lung. Because you can imagine if I collapse one lung, why I give this a normal tidal volume. I think we can use 5-6 milliliter. No, this large volume, or this is a normal volume, it helps us to shift and to produce, prevent atelectasis. So don't use low tidal volume because it will produce atelectasis. And don't use over tidal volume because it reduce increase in the shunt. It works like PEEP to the upper lung. Respiratory rate, it should be kept to keep the PaCO2 from 35, around 35, which is normal. Don't produce hypocarbia or hypercarbia, because this will affect the hypoxic pulmonary vasoconstrictive reflex. This reflex is mandatory. Don't abolish or don't inhibit this reflex. In expiratory-expiratory ratio, it should permit enough expiration to prevent air trapping. In expiratory flow rate, it should be laminar flow. Don't produce high flow, because it will produce more turbulence and will increase the resistance and increase the pressure. Peak airway pressure should be kept less than 30 to 40 centimeter water. Continuous positive airway pressure and positive end expiratory pressure. Some authors prefer to give CPAP 5 to 10 centimeter to the collapsed lung by differential lung ventilation. And this is effective measure. But others try to use PEEP to the ventilated lung, and this can divert blood to the non-ventilated lung, especially if the PEEP is large. So we, if you use PEEP, we should be very cautious. CPAP to the collapsed lung by differential lung ventilation, and PEEP to the ventilated lung. Recently, some try to do researches for lung protective strategy in the operation room in one lung ventilation. But this is still under research, if we can do lung protective strategy with low tidal volume, and we can increase the rate, but still under research. Of course, to decrease the effect of one lung ventilation, the period should be kept to a minimum. Immediate re-expansion of the collapsed lung if the hypoxia or hypoxemia is persisting. If hypoxia persists, you should search for the possible cause. Repeat fiber optic bronchoscopy and revise the position of the double lumen or the device you use. Both lumen can be used to suction any blood or secretions that can obstruct the airway. Sometimes, and we find it, and we can miss this point, the surgeon work on the upper non-dependent lung, but sometimes the dependent ventilated side get pneumothorax, because most of these people are, and these patients are, have a bilateral pathology, not single pathology. So we are concentrating that the lower lung will be ventilated, but sometimes this lower dependent lung get pneumothorax. And sometimes during the surgical dissection itself. Periodic inflation, intermittent two lung ventilation, we use this technique many times if the hypoxia persists. Early ligation or clamping of the ipsilateral pulmonary artery during pneumonectomy, we can do. And the continuous oxygen insufflation into the collapsed lung. Here, the oxygen insufflation, it is not CPAP or PEEP. It is just opening the flowmeter on oxygen and allow the air to flow freely without any pressure to the collapsed lung. This helps in some cases. Number nine, to avoid fluid overload and avoid factors which inhibit hypoxic pulmonary vasoconstrictive reflex. Very high or very low pulmonary artery pressure, hypocapnia, very high or very low mixed venous pressure, vasodilators, because all vasodilators will inhibit this reflex, inhalational anesthetics. So it is preferable to use total intravenous anesthesia instead of the inhalational anesthesia. Recently, many researchers try to use the inhaled nitric oxide, because nitric oxide will produce vasodilatation to the ventilated lung, which is the dependent lung. And sometimes we combine almitrine, which is a peripheral chemoreceptor agonist, intravenous in a low dose, and it will produce more vasoconstriction by intravenous route. It produces more vasoconstriction to the upper lung. So the combination of inhaled nitric oxide and intravenous low-dose alimetrine can help and eliminate this hypoxia. How to do one-lung ventilation? There are three main techniques. Double-lumen endobronchial, single-lumen endotracheal, and the single-lumen endobronchial. Double-lumen endobronchial, it is easy and famous technique. You have the ability to ventilate either one or both lung, and have the ability to suction either from one or both lung. There is many types. The most famous is Robert Cho. Right or left? The most famous is the left Robert Cho. I will tell you why the left is usually we use it. Robert Cho is usually presented in a disposable left side version. We have many gauges, 26, 28, 32, 35, 37, 39, 41. And the first three are recently available, and they are used for children. The children more than 30 kilogram body weight and more than 8 to 10 years old. Younger children, we never use double-lumen. I will tell you why later on in the lecture. So what the meaning of French gauge? The French gauge, it measure the external circumference. In anesthesia, we have two main sizes, the catheter French size and the needle gauge size. The catheter French size, it measure the external circumference, which is more related to the anatomy. The ordinary endotracheal tube, we know tube number 7, tube number 8, tube number 6. These figures is represented the internal diameter in millimeter. And this corresponding to the physiology. It coapt with the physiology more than the anatomy. If you want to know the size of the trachea and which size, you know, you either use the outer diameter of the tube or the French gauge. This is the figure showing the French gauges. So here, the external diameter, if you multiply by which is 22 over 7, this represents the external circumference of any circle. So, example, if you have a 5-size French gauge catheter, we'll have outside diameter 5 multiplied by 0.3, it will be 1.65 millimeter. Increase in the number of the French gauge, increase the diameter and increase the external circumference of the gauge. So this catheter French gauge is used in the nasogastric tube, double lumen tube, urinary catheter. But if you use needles, the needles has a different gauge, like arterial cannula, like central line, like peripheral ordinary intravenous cannula. Here the gauge is different. It is not in the same figures. You have an area, this area about 1 inch in diameter. If you put in this area 13 or 14 needle, so the gauge will be 14. But if you can put 20, so the gauge will be 20. So these figures, which represent the needle gauges, it is the number of the needles which can put in this specific area. So you can observe and you know that it is in the reverse manner. When the figure is large, so it is a smaller needle. When the figure is small, it is a larger needle. Here you can see the Robert Cho tube. And of course, the figure on the right, this is the old obsolete reusable. Now it is in the history, but the left tubes are the disposable tubes. And this is the Carlin's, although it is also very rare to use and to see them in the operating theaters, but I bring these to see what is the carinal hook. You see here, at the terminal or the distal end, there is carinal hook. This carinal hook, it is invented to rest on the carina of the trachea, but usually it produces injury during introduction of the tube. The ordinary Robert show, it has two lumen, two curve, two cuffs. Two lumen, one lumen for the trachea and other lumen for the bronchus. Two curve, one ordinary curve, and have a distal performed curve either to the or to the left. And this curve, the distal curve, determine this tube is right side tube or left side tube. When we will use the right side tube, it is designed for left thoracotomy. You can imagine that the patient will sleep in the lateral decubitus and will put your tube and will insert it on the right side. So the right lung will be ventilated. It is the lower lung, while the left lung, it is the upper lung. So it is left thoracotomy. And the reverse with the left side tube. The left side tube is usually used for thoracotomy non-pulmonary surgery. If the surgeon will do non-pulmonary surgery, we usually use the left side tube. And now, maybe from 10 years ago, in our theaters, we only see the left side tube. The right side tube is very rare to see. I will tell you why now. Two cuffs, there is a bronchial cuff and there is tracheal cuff. The bronchial cuff, as you see in the images, in the lower image, there is a slit. There is Murphy eye in the cuff. This to ventilate the right upper lobe. And it should be adjusted in position. This is why we usually don't prefer to use the right tube. The right side tube, you should put in a correct position and you should put this slit in front of the bronchi, bronchus of the upper right lung loop. How to select the size of the tube? Generally, we want to put the tube atraumatically. And of course, as I told you, you should depend on the gauge which represented the anatomy, not the physiology here. So we use the French gauge. We don't put in mind the other inner diameter gauge you used to know in the ordinary tubes. And if you put the tube, you should allow air to pass, but without air leak from the bronchial cuff if it is inflated. So we usually choose and select a double lumen tube with a bronchial end that is 1 or 2 millimeters smaller than the outer diameter of the intubated bronchus. The selected size is chosen either. You can use the most common size for tall and short male and female, as we see in the table before. But sometimes we can depend on chest X-ray and the CT or three-dimensional CT scan reconstruction. And this imaging techniques can give us an idea about the size of the left main bronchus diameter or the right main bronchus if you insert in the right or the left. And to know the diameter of the left main bronchus. Also, we can use the CT chest and chest X-ray to know the tracheal diameter. If you get the tracheal diameter, usually the left main bronchus is 0.75 for men and 0.75 for women, in relation to the tracheal diameter. How to confirm the proper tube position. After you put the tube, you should do twice, double check. First, immediate after tube placement, and then after patient position, because you will put the tube while the patient in the supine position, and then the surgeon and the assistant will put the patient in the lateral decubital position. You should check the tube for another time after positioning. The confirmation is usually done by auscultation, a preset protocol. We close the bronchial and here and close the tracheal and here. It is preset protocol, very easy to do. And it is better now to use the flexible fiber optic bronchoscopy. Usually the distal cuff, the bronchial cuff, it is in a blue to be very easy identified during flexible fiber optic bronchoscopy. Double lumen tubes has many complications. Hypoxemia, the tube misplacement or occlusion, traumatic laryngitis, especially if you will use the one with carinal hook, tracheal bronchial disruption or laceration if there is overinflation of the bronchial cuff, and sometimes it is sutured by the surgeon during surgery. You will see how the tube is sutured. Sometimes the surgeon, the field is narrow and the field contains blood, so he will not see the tube and he will do suturing. So you can detect this while you want to withdraw the tube at the end of the surgery. The second technique to do one lung ventilation in a single lumen endobronchial tube with a bronchial plucker. I will go through them. There are many types, and every couple or 3 years, someone invent a new technique. These bronchial blockers, we put either beside the tube or inside the tube. It can be used either that. We use a Univesity tube, uniplucker, arendet, Cohen, flexitip, and Roche bronchial blocker, and inflatable catheters. The advantage of this blocker is it is simple to use, cheaper, and can be used in adult and pediatric because it is a single lumen. Never to use a double lumen in very young age. I will tell you why later on. But now this bronchial blocker is used with a tube of single lumen. So you can use in adult and pediatric and even in infant. It can be used in a patient with a difficult airway in emergency condition because it is very easy to put and very easy to isolate. Channel within the blocker allow the lung to deflate and to allow you to do suctioning and insufflation of oxygen. At the end of surgery, there is no need to change the endotracheal tube at the end of the surgery because only you will remove the bronchial blocker, but you leave the tube in place to allow postoperative ventilation. But of course, bronchial blockers in comparison to the double lumen tubes has many disadvantages. Inability to suction efficiently or intermittently ventilate the lung distal to the blocker without deflating balloon. The endobronchial blocker should be placed under direct visualization with guidance of fiber optic. Difficult to maintain in position. It is easily to slip and easily to enter the right main bronchus. Easily to slip, and sometimes it is in life-threatening tracheal obstruction. Bilateral lung ventilation, if the cuff is not inflated properly, inadvertent suturing like the double lumen tube, and the cuff of some blockers have a high pressure, low volume, which will produce an harmful effect on the bronchial wall. The first is a univent tube. Here is something for the my colleagues who will not, their mother language is English. Although the first letter in the univent is U, we must put a letter A, not N. Sometimes in exam I see someone write an univent tube. No, univent, you should write by a univent tube, not an univent tube. It is a single lumen with built site in channel. This is the univent tube. It is in the wall. It is a channel, special channel. It is a retractable tube. It contains a balloon at the distal end. Its diameter is 3.5 to 9 millimeter internal diameter. This is, of course, the tube. So you can see 3.5 tube. So you can use it in smaller children. But usually, if you will use a univent tube, the child should be more than 1 year age. It is really used nowadays, but sometimes used in emergency condition like pulmonary hemorrhage. A uniblocker. This is a blocker of univented loop, but it is separately used. The company put a connector, which you can connect it to any tube, and you will put the uniblocker inside the ordinary tube. Cop-dish blocker, it has some advantage that you can do some rotation at the tip. As you see, there is a blue rural. You can change it, and you can change the direction of the tip. This helps to reduce proper positioning. Arendt endobronchial blocker, sometimes called wire-guided or snare-guided endobronchial blocker, whip. It is invented by George Arendt, 1994. As you see, it is the yellow in color and has a connector. The connector has four ports, one for the tube, one for the ventilation, and one for the fiber optic, and one for the Arendt. The Arendt has an internal lumen with a snare-guided wire. We put the fiber optic inside this snare, and introduce both the Arendt and the fiber optic bronchoscopy through the ordinary tube until they get out from the distal opening of the tube. And then by the while you are seeing the fiber optic, you can direct the Arendt to put it in the position you want, either in the left bronchus or in the right bronchus. This Arendt has many balloon shape, either spherical or elliptical or pear shape. These different shapes allow more sealing and decrease the dislodgement of the Arendt. It is available in three main sizes, 9 French and 7 French and 5 French, which is the smallest and used with the tube is 4.5 millimeter internal diameter. And of course, these tubes available in two lengths, adult lengths and the pediatric length. Cohen tip deflecting flex tip endobronchial blocker. It has a rural and you can direct the tip of the Cohen blocker either to the right or the left, and this will give you more control and more proper positioning of the wheel. It is also can be used for normal endotracheal tube. An inflatable catheter like Fogarty embolectomy catheter, Fools urological catheter, Swan-Ganz catheter, McGill balloon tipped luminal catheter, or atherosceptomy catheter. All these are trial to produce one lung ventilation. Of course, they are not the ideal and they are a trial. I never use them, but they are present in the literatures and in the references. We should mention them. There is a single lumen endobronchial tube. Actually, there are two devices. The one is the Gordon green tube, and it is usually it is a right side tube to be inserted in the right bronchus, and it contains a slit also for the upper lobe. You can do ventilation of both lungs if you deflate the bronchial cuff, but of course the ventilation will be unequal. And if you want to isolate one lung, you will inflate the bronchial blocker. The bronchial cuff, but you always inflate the tracheal cuff. It is has a hook. It has a hook, so there is a risk of laryngitis and inability to suction from the left lung. We can use ordinary uncut single lumen endobronchial tube, and this is a famous technique if you don't have any of the previous devices. So you can use ordinary tube and either to introduce this tube either to the left bronchus or to the right bronchus. Of course, if you direct the tube in the neutral position, it will enter an adult to the right bronchus, because this is in continuity with the trachea and has a less angle with the trachea. But if you wanted to direct this ordinary tube to the left bronchus, after you pass through the vocal cord, you just rotate the tube to the left side. You will direct its curve to the left side and will enter easily to the left bronchus. If you wanted to do double lung ventilation, you will withdraw the tube to the trachea. If you want to do single lung ventilation, you can redirect the tube to a single lung. Of course, it is should be guided by bronchoscopy to produce proper positioning. I have only four slides more, and I need to finish. There is one lung ventilation in tracheostomy. If the patient has a tracheostomy tube, so you can use either double lumen tube or univent tube, or you can use the bronchial blocker, or you can use a single lumen tube inserted blindly or fiber optically. One lung ventilation in pediatric, it is an very important item, and usually in exam they ask for it, how to do in pediatric. And sometimes they give you a case with a specific age or a specific weight of the child, like a child has 5 years old, and we wanted to do a one lung ventilation. How to do this one lung ventilation? So if you mention small double lumen tube, you will be wrong, because small double lumen endobronchial tube, it needs a child more than 8 to 10 years of age or more than 30 kilogram body weight. Never, although the manufacturers can do any lumen to be double lumen, but during the physiology and the physics, if you see this slide, this is a Hagen-Boise formula or equation. You see the flow is proportional dependent to the delta pressure and the radius to power of 4. So the radius here is very important. If you increase the radius, you will increase the flow. But if you decrease the radius, even 1 millimeter, the flow will decrease very much. So never to use a small tube in small children, or even if it enters the trachea. The matter here is not only anatomy. It is a physiology, it is a physics. If you decrease the diameter of the tube, the resistance will be very, very high, and the flow will be very, very low. Single lumen endobronchial tube with a bronchial blocker can be used, like univent tube, Fogarty embolectic catheter, RNDET. And you can see here that RNDET can be used in infant. Fogarty embolectomy catheter and the Swan guns can be used in infant. Ordinary uncut tube also can be used in infant. So you can expect to be asked how to produce one lung ventilation in infant, not only in children. Last thing is one lung, this is the last slide, is one lung ventilation was difficult intubation. If you confronted with a patient with a difficult airway and you need to do one lung ventilation, so you had either two pathways, either to secure a single lumen tube, like any other difficult intubation. And after you're securing the tube by fiber optic, by laryngeal mask intubating, or any other device, so you have either to complete the surgery with this single lumen tube, or you add an independent bronchial blocker, or you change the single lumen tube with tube exchanger to get the double lumen or a univent tube. This lecture is present in my book. This is my book, Spotlight of Anesthesia and Intensive Care. It is present in this book. And this is my contacts. And I hope you enjoy this lecture. And I'm sorry I'm late 4 minutes more. but I hope you enjoy this lecture. I will get now out from the share screen.
Thanks, Dr. Hesham. Really attractive and informative lecture. And we are really enjoyed with your